Writing in the Daily Mail today, Lorna Martin suggests that far from being a male thing, the midlife crisis is also affecting women. As well as turning to cosmetic surgery and having affairs, other symptoms to watch out for include boredom, loneliness, drinking too much, and changing partners regularly. Essentially, wanting to change your life completely or to hold back the years. So, have we been there and done that? Are we in the thick of it? I'm almost scared to float the question.
Well, I guess I'm the person that ticks all the boxes. I guess I've been in a midlife crisis all my life. But I guess...
No, you haven't.
No, when I turned 50, I think that was the time it hit me most of all, I guess. And I found it very hard to cope with it. But don't forget that I'd been through bad things. I was on my own. You know, loneliness is one of the worst things, isn't it, when you're on your own? Eventually, that comes at you. And I did think that surgery would help. It didn't help. It doesn't help. It doesn't change you. It doesn't change anything. And I think that was the worst thing for me. I think loneliness is a hard thing to cope with when you're on your own, but you have to come to terms with it. That's the end of the story. I think I look at somebody like Carol, who I find as a role model is a very good role model in the sense that she's strong. Well, she's a strong woman. She's not a people pleaser. She doesn't have, you know, she doesn't bow or kowtow to anybody. She is her own person. And I found that very difficult to be that person. Now, if I'd have found that strength within me earlier on in my life to do that, I may have not have had the self problem, you know, the, what do you call it? The
self-doubt and all that.
I wouldn't have had all that. I would have been able to cope with that. But because of certain circumstances that have hit me, like losing all my money, not losing my house, losing everything. When you get to 50 and you didn't think you were ever going to be there with nothing after all those years of working, that's quite a hard thing to take on board, thinking, I'm 50, I've now got to start all over again and start earning till the day I die because I don't have any money. And
yeah,
I don't
know. It's demoralising.
It is demoralising.
And when things like that, I mean, you've come back.
Say, so, Sherry, you know, you've got to give yourself some credit. You've rewritten yourself into a success story, and you never ever seem to take that on board.
No, I don't. What I'm trying to explain is that I'm not sitting here feeling sorry for myself. Don't think that. What I'm trying to explain is that a midlife crisis can be that, and it's sometimes hard to every day bolster yourself and come out of it.
Well,
I know
some people deal with it in different ways. I mean, I've never had anything like, you know, a massive crisis where, you know, I've never slipped into those habits, the ones that you just listed.
What, extreme drinking,
not
shopping.
In a serious.
She does that for enjoyment. I do that for fun.
I don't do it to drown any kind of angst or sorrow. But you know, there was a time when, you know, for a couple of years, just as I was coming up to 40, or just after 40 it might have been, and I wasn't working too much and I didn't have much to do, and I don't know, just I began to think, this isn't the way it's supposed to be.
Yeah.
And, you know, I don't know what happened, but I just, every morning I would get up and I would force myself, even though I had nowhere to go and no job, I would get up and put a suit on and walk around, go around my house in a suit.
Oh.
I did it because I thought I could see how easy it could be to just lay in bed all day, watch daytime telly, and wear a tracksuit and eat cornflakes. Yeah. You know,
feel worth fighting back. That made you feel something positive. And I think there's always an answer. You've got to keep fighting. There's always an answer, or there's something that will rectify the situation you're in. I mean, I was living probably a year with Jay. And then, from being split up from my ex. And I had my best friend who was just, we were so close, Sarah, and she moved to America. And I remember the day she left, I felt so lost. I thought, right, I've done 15 years in the West End Theatre. I don't want to do that. I want to put my baby to bed. What on earth am I going to do to pay the bills? So I put my house on the market. I thought, I'm going home to Birmingham. I've got my family. Everything will be fine. And although I knew it was the wrong thing to do, I needed to make a decision. I needed to make a move. And I spoke to my friend that night, and I was sobbing down the phone. And I said, I don't know whether I'm making the right decision. I wish my dad was here so he could tell me, you know. And she said, I don't think you are. Think about it. And the next morning, I got a call from the BBC asking me to be vocal coach for How Do You Solve a Problem Like Maria? And that was it. And it was like, there was my answer. But I was in such a despair. But there's always an answer. There is always a solution. You've just got to look for it. That's what I think.
Yeah. Absolutely. Well, there's always an answer, and there's always a competition question.